Thank you, Chairman Cleaver, for waving me on, for waving me on, and Ranking Member Hill for holding this hearing, and thank you to our witnesses for sharing your expertise with us today. The deprivation of women's bodily autonomy for political ends is not a phenomenon limited to one time or place. From Boko Haram and Al-Shabaab kidnappings to small-scale Boston traffickers, exploiters are making a profit by trading in trauma and condemning families to a lifetime of fear for their children's safety. Mr. Atkins, how is trafficking used to further the goals of these insurgencies? And why is human trafficking, including sexual exploitation specifically, so effective in terrorizing local communities?
Thank you for your question, Representative Pressley. The first thing that I would say is that there is a general overarching sense in the world of essentially patriarchy and the diminishment of the value, worth, and protection of women in our society and certainly in many nations abroad. And so that would be kind of the overarching piece of this. The second piece is that even though terrorist organizations don't have very strong links in terms of the actual transport and kind of cross-border movement of trafficked persons, they certainly are consumers of trafficked women and children as porters, as sex slaves, concubines, as people to be forced into marriage. And so essentially what trafficked people create for many of these terrorist organizations is a base of consumption to feed themselves, to sustain their movements, to keep the morale of their soldiers high, to actually entice young men to join on to terrorist movements with this idea that you would have power at the point of a gun and that you would have access to women all the way up to your liking. The other piece of this is that, again, even though the ties are not strong in terms of linking them directly to doing trafficking, that they actually create the conditions that induce vulnerability for more people.
Okay.
And so because of what Boko Haram has been doing in Nigeria, trafficking writ large in Nigeria has become a more serious problem. And it's a more serious problem for more vulnerable people. And so any type of organizations that create displacement, that create refugee flows, that create internally displaced persons are by dint of that action creating more people who will be disconnected from state services and protection, disconnected from their families, and then by dint of that, more vulnerable to being brought into the dark underworld of transnational criminal organizations and terrorist groups.
Thank you. Thank you for that comprehensive response, Mr. Atkins. Just in the interest of time, I'll try to conflate my two final questions and hear from whoever would like to contribute. I want to bring a survivor into this to the discussion. I represent the Massachusetts 7th, work closely with a survivor-led organization called My Life, My Choice, and the Ava Center as well, who work with survivors of trafficking to rebuild and recover. Now, survivors face obstacles in reclaiming their financial agency. This is something we don't often talk about. My Life, My Choice shared the story of one such survivor, Kendra. She grew up in state care due to parental substance use and sexual abuse in the home. By age 13, had met her first exploiter. Kendra continued to face sexual exploitation through her teens and her early 20s. By the time she escaped for good, her Social Security had been stolen by her exploiters, and credit cards and an auto loan fraudulently taken out in her name. Although case managers were able to help Kendra appeal this credit fraud in court, many survivors lack access to this support. So I just want to make sure that we're thinking both about prevention and recovery. So Ms. Nugent-Swift, how can banks better help survivors appeal and correct fraud and reclaim ownership of their finances?
Thank you. An extremely important issue. I think there are two connected items here that you've hit. One is, how do we restore credit for the survivors? And then two, how do we get them access once they've extracted themselves from their lived experience? There's a lot of efforts that are being done today with banks through the Liechtenstein Initiative, who are trying to create internal policies and procedures in order to evaluate with social work organizations new accounts that are being created for survivors so that they can get their foot in the door. Once they get their foot in the door, then their accounts and can go through the normal system, and then they can build their credit that way. But I think the root cause really is, how do we restore credit for the survivors? Because if we are able to help them restore their credit and we're able to help that conversation start, then they can, you know, apply for any type of financial services. So I think we need to bring those agencies who are responsible for evaluating credit, to the table to have that conversation to identify solutions. So credit bureaus and agencies and things like that. Banks, unfortunately, cannot, because once, bad activities happen,
gentlelady's time has expired. Thank you.